Hello. In this video, we are going to learn about material testing. Why do we need to test material? We need to do a reproducible result so that we can tell the properties of the materials that we're working with. There's two kinds of testing: static testing, which we have a constant load that we put on a material and we see its reaction, and dynamic testing is when we vary the load or we vary the different conditions, including cycling and mode and the magnitude of the forces that we apply. We're going to talk mainly about static material testing. We're not going to do any dynamic material testing. When we do this, what we're looking for is we want to find the strength of the material. We want to find out if it deforms at all when we put it under pressure. Where does it want to change shape? Or does it want to break and fracture? Or does the design meet the compliance requirements? There are three standard tests we do to test material: a tensile test, a compression test, and a hardness test. We're going to mainly focus on the tensile test, and I'm going to show you quite a bit about that now, and then at the end we'll talk just a little bit about compression and hardness test. For a tensile test, what we're doing is putting a straight line force applied to a test sample, typically in the y direction. You'll see right here in this example, we would stick something, a sample of material in here, and then we're going to apply force to try and in the y direction to try and pull it apart to see what happens. It's called destructive testing if we apply the force until the sample fails, which is what we're going to practice. We're going to be destructive testers here in the next few days and see just how much force it takes to break different types of materials. So when you do tensile testing, you need a test sample. We can't just take a full beam and build a machine big enough to stick the beam in it. So what we do is we take a sample of the material that the beam is made out of, which is much smaller, and it's called a test sample, or a dog bone is what PLTW likes to call it. This way we can have meaningful and reproducible results over and over, so we know that it's a true property of the material itself and not just of the sample. Our test samples, when we go to the tensile structural stress analyzer, will look like this down here. So what happens is we create the dog bones to a specific test specification. So this is the blueprint for each one of our samples, and they look like this. Here's an example of red brass, and here's an example of, this looks kind of like aluminum. And then we put the dog bone, or the stress sample, into the tester. And then we apply a force. Let's go back. We're going to apply a force like pulling here. This is going to stay static, and we're going to pull here, which is our force. We're going to see what happens to this metal under different amounts of force. So this is kind of what your graph looks like when you're finished, and it's uniform. It's this basic shape for every single material, but it varies a little bit based on the material. So we're going to talk about the important properties of this graph. So the tension force is applied until a failure occurs, which means it's going to break. Simultaneously, the applied tension and elongation of your material are recorded. So this is the plot that's created. So let's look at test sample A and B. They're both 230 red brass, but one is smaller than the other. So test sample A has a diameter of 0.125 inches right here. We're talking about the diameter of this part right here. And test sample B has a diameter of 0.375 inches. So if both samples are tested to failure, will the applied tension force and the elongation be the same? No, they will not. As you can guess, with a bigger diameter, we'll have a little bit different results. Load and elongation results are dependent on your sample size. The larger sample indicates a larger load elongation. So how can test data be manipulated to represent a material and not an individual sample? This is when we talk about stress and strain. So to eliminate our test results based on sample size, we calculate stress, which is the load per unit of area. So we're going to divide out the area to get a unit. Divide load which is F, by the original test sample cross-sectional area. And remember, it was a cylinder. So here's your formula for stress. You're going to want to write this in your notebook right now. Also this one, this is with the symbols. This little sigma here represents stress. This is what we're talking about. Remember, your sample was cylindrical. And so if I were to cut this in half and look at it, it would be a circle. So the area here is going to be pi r squared. So if I take the radius, so I'm going to do the diameter and divide it by 2, and I'm going to square it, multiply by pi, my area is 0.0123 inches squared. So I take, if I put 430 pounds of force on this thing and divide, then this is pounds per inches squared, so PSI, pounds per square inch, 35,000 pounds per square inch of stress. Manipulating results. So now we need to do the same thing only for our elongation results. So instead, we're going to have, instead of stress was for force, strain is for elongation. So it's the amount of stretch per unit of length. So elongation is strain. You're going to want to take a minute and write these two formulas down in your engineering notebook. Strain is the amount of stretch divided by the original length. So when we look at this, we figure out and calculate the strain on the dog bone with an elongation of 0.0625. So that's how far it stretched. My original length is 1. So I'm going to divide those two, and my strain is 0.0625. And so this is what your stress versus strain graph will look like. There's some really important features on this graph. If you'll notice, it appears to be linear for a little while before it takes off and does like this little curvy thing. It goes up and then comes back down. These all mean something to us in the testing process, so let's talk about that. My initial response is linear, so that means as the stress goes up, so does the strain. Here's this part right here. Stress and strain are proportional to one another. So as one goes up, the other goes up. This is called the elastic range. So I want you to draw this graph in your notebook, and I want you to highlight this with a color and then label it elastic range. This is elastic. What does that mean? It is in the point right up here at the top where it changes from being linear to curved is called the proportional limit. So I want you to draw a star up here at the top of your linear segment, and I want you to label that proportional limit. This is where proportionality ceases to exist. What does elastic range mean? Elastic means this is where we can stretch it, and if we stop stretching it before we reach this proportional limit, then it will go back to its original shape. So we talked about modulus of elasticity when we did the beam deflection, and so this is the proportional constant. Whatever the slope of this line is, the ratio of stress over strain, the slope of this line is how you find your modulus of elasticity. So here's a formula for stress over strain. The modulus of elasticity, if you'll remember, is a measure of stiffness, and it's the ability for a material to resist stretching when loaded. So a higher modulus of elasticity means it's more resistant to stretching. It's a property, an inherent property of any given material. So notice here, if the load is removed, the test sample will return to its original length. This is elastic or recoverable. So this would be non-destructive testing. We're not going to, and we're exaggerating the stretch to illustrate the principle of elastic range. So that's really important. This is your elastic limit. It's the uppermost stress that we can put on it and still have elastic behavior. The elastic and proportional limit are almost identical, but the elastic limit is just a tiny bit higher than that proportional limit. Let's talk about resilience. What is resilience? The amount of energy per unit of volume that a material can absorb while in the elastic range. So it's the area under the stress-strain curve. So if you'll notice, what shape does this make right here? This area is a triangle, and how do we find the area of a triangle? Half the base times the height. So why would it be important for car designers to understand the resilience of a material? Remember, resilience is the amount of energy per unit of volume that a material can absorb. So why would it be important on a car bumper to be able to absorb energy? So we want to have a high resilience for whatever material we make the bumper out of. Okay, just beyond our elastic limit is the yield point. This is the tiniest increase in stress produces a much greater strain. So this is where we really take off. Right here, it's been pretty much, as this one goes up, this one does, this one goes up. This one goes up a tiny amount, this one goes way up. So as the stress goes up a tiny amount, the strain goes way up. Most materials do not have a well-defined yield point. But you just need to understand it's a little bit past the elastic limit. So then, 0.2% past your elastic limit is your offset yield strength. This defines the stress required to produce a tolerable amount of permanent strain. So this is where we will not go back to our original shape once we reach this offset yield strength. So I'd like for you right now to put another star on your paper just above your elastic limit and label it offset yield strength. So this curvy part, this is called the elastic range because you can stretch it and it will go back here. But this curvy part after we get to the yield is called plastic deformation. So this word should give you a hint as to that once we get into this area, there's no going back to being elastic. It's unrecoverable elongation beyond the elastic limit. When the load is removed, the elastic deformation will be recovered. Plastic deformation represents failure. This is the destructive part of our destructive testing. Part dimensions will now be outside of allowable tolerances. It will not go back to its original shape. You will have distorted it too much. This is deformation right here. So your test sample goes way too long and is deformed. And so would you please mark your graph in your engineering notebook with this curly brace and the word deformation. Your cross-sectional area is getting smaller and smaller because when I make it longer, then I'm making that thickness in the middle less. But my load-bearing ability increases, so I'm having less area, but it's handling a better load. Why is that? The material's getting stronger, but how is that? That's because your weakest point is stretched and that makes it stronger. And then your weakest point is stretched and that becomes stronger until each new weakest point is stretched and it becomes stronger. Until the decrease in area overcomes the increase in strength, which is right here at the end of this deformation, then we're going to lose this strengthening ability. So tensile strength is this point right up here at the very top where your deformation happens. I'd like for you to put a star here and label tensile strength. This is where your load-bearing ability peaks. This is the final point where you're taking your weakest point and making it stronger. After this, we're just making it weaker and weaker. So the force required to continue straining the test sample decreases. So now we can use less force and still strain our sample. The weakest location at the peak continues to decrease in area, and this is called necking. And here's an example of what we mean by necking, where it's just about to break apart, but it hasn't quite yet, and you see these indentions on the side here. That's what we're looking for when we get to this tensile strength. Almost broken, but not quite. Failure happens if we continue to apply a force past this tensile strength. The necking is going to happen and we will break it apart, as you saw in the animation here. Ductility is the amount of plasticity before fracture. How much will it stretch out before it actually breaks is called ductility. So look at these three samples. The material, these are three different types of metals, and these all broke differently. So this one has more ductility than this one, and this one has more ductility than this one, because this one was able to deform more and had more necking than this one. This one had hardly any at all. It just broke in half, so it's not very ductile. Another thing that we can see on a tensile test is brittleness. Material failure with little or no ductility. And that's what we see right here in this example right here. No ductility. It's a lack of being ductile, not a lack of strength. It can still be a very strong metal. It's just not very ductile, meaning it will not stretch very much beyond its load point. Tough. How tough a material is depends on the work per unit of volume required to fracture the material. So it's the total area, not just this triangular area, but the total area under the stress strain curve from test initiation to fracture. And right here at the end, let's put a star here at the end, this is fracture. We're not going to do much with this because because it's an odd shape, this requires calculus. This is why you need to know calculus so you can find this area. So that's it for our tensile testing. Now we're just going to kind of talk a little bit about the other two tests because I want to keep this video as brief as possible, even though it's already too long. So sorry. Compression testing is the stress and strain relationships are similar to tension, but they have a large cross-sectional area and to resist bending and buckling. So we're going to be, instead of trying to pull them apart, we're going to kind of be pushing them together, pressing them, applying force and pressure. So the material strengthens by stretching laterally and increasing its cross-sectional area. And then we can test for hardness. And the way we do this, there's a Brinell hardness test where we take a tungsten carbide ball held with 500 pounds of force, and we put it into the material for 15 seconds, and then we see how big of a crater is made. And that's how we tell if something is hard or if something is soft. So for example, diamonds are the hardest material, so if we did this with a tungsten carbide ball, we should not have very much indention at all. Aluminum is much, much softer, so we should have a noticeable crater if we were to do the Brinell hardness test. Also, the Rockwell test is also a hardness test. This is where a diamond-tipped cone is forced into the test sample again because diamond is a very hard substance. And you measure how far it penetrates the material, and then that's how we know how something is softer, is it has more penetration. And that's it for our tensile testing. Now we're going to practice with a simulation on the computer, reading our results and finding and practicing these terms that I had you copy down from the graph. Thank you for listening.